Good evening, Forum. Hope you're well. Tonight I'm again back with like a big ass video review on SIG rifles. As you know, I'm based in Switzerland, and here, instead of AR-15s, we got SIGs. I pretty much got the whole lineup here, starting with the traditional SIG 550, in Switzerland known as Sturmgewehr 90. This means like translates to assault rifle 90. I got the SIG 551 SWAT, same caliber as SIG 550, that is 5.56. This one's got like a, I think something like a 14.5 inch barrel. As you can see, it's painted in sort of like a desert tan and black. And then the last member of the family, SIG 553. This one is sort of really the latest in the lineup that came out, and the successor of the 552. Difference being between this and the latter is about the system, how it works. The piston, instead of being at the back, pushing towards the front like in an AK, it's in the front, and it hooks up to the bolt carrier in a similar fashion to the 551 and the 550. You probably already know this, but still, cool to say. Later on, we're gonna have a look at the inside. We're gonna see what I mean. Of course, there are also other variations, namely the one with long barrels. I think both the 553 and the 551 are available in this configuration. The long barrel versions have the ability of attaching the grenade launcher, which this one lacks, and this 551 in this configuration, I'm not so sure, perhaps you can already attach it to that one. You can also attach the bayonet in the long barrel, although I have the bayonet lock on this one as well. You can attach a special bayonet on this one, which I do not have, for obvious reasons. I do not need it actually. So. But yeah, without further ado, what's the agenda for this video? Basically, I'm going to show you pretty much what the characteristics are of these rifles. Once you see one, you probably see them all. But yeah, still, since otherwise, what would be the purpose of doing this video? I'm going to show you a bit, I'm going to tell you a bit about the real-world applications, how it works out, what's my take on these guns, and yeah. I'm going to show you a bit the attachments that I run with these ones, tell you about the precision. Yeah, I think it's going to be a nice little lineup of SIGs. There are not so many reviews about these ones on the web, mainly because it's hard to get to buy those in America, where the biggest gun community is. I think in Canada there's a bunch of people running those. I haven't seen a lot of reviews either, so similar to my review on the G36. Or HK243, this is going to be a review on a gun that is quite exotic, at least for what concerns the YouTube environment. Let's start with this one, 550. This is my service rifle. Yeah, in Switzerland they don't call it like this, they call it always under the government name Sturmgewehr 90, which is like assault rifle 90. So this is how you basically usually see this this rifle on the market. What it is yeah, it's the standard rifle you're able to bring it home after you finish with your service. You can keep it home as long as you're not done with your compulsory 3 weeks per year service, which you have to do after boot camp until you like you're really done with the service days that match your rank. Let's say that you're a soldier, you have, I don't know, 300 days of service in total, boot camp lasts 150. So the remaining 150, you serve them in batch of 3 weeks per year after you're done. Of course, there are some exceptions. Some people do more, some people do less, but overall, that's the rule. So, all these years where you have to go for the compulsory 3 weeks, this rifle says you go home. You can have it transferred to you after you're done with all of these yearly service weeks. it's not so easy like before, unfortunately. You're required to take part to some shooting challenges in the last 2 years, I think. And then if they see this on your shooting record, that you took part to these shooting championships, and sort of this justifies the need for a rifle for shooting purposes, then you can request to have it transferred to you. They, in the warehouse or I don't know where, they do some moldings in this side. You're not able to shoot fully auto with it anymore. It's gonna be basically a semi-auto sporting rifle. But you get it for free, actually. You only have to pay for the paper, which is seeing is around $100 or $110, something like this. But it's okay, you know, you can still sell it for $1,000, $1,500, depends on how much use or abuse it has. Mine is pretty abused, so. But I want to resell it anyway, you know, if it's a nice souvenir, you know, something nice to put on the wall or actually to use at the range, whatever you like. So what is this actually? Well, a 5.56 gun, the working sound compared to a Kalashnikov. I wouldn't really compare it to a Kalashnikov. The 5.52 would be like a Kalashnikov. This one is a bit different, okay? Some people say that this is really like the nirvana of shooting precision. I don't know, at 300 meters, it definitely, with iron sights, you can pretty much do some nice groupings. The barrel is not free-floating on this one, as we're gonna see in a minute. So basically, to take this sucker apart, I would advise one thing. So the way I do it, first take this one off, rear takedown pin, you slowly let the bolt carrier and carrier slide out. Front takedown pin, they're all captive. There you go. So this is the upper receiver. Next move. Yeah, it's a bit dirty. Okay, so here's the lower handguard with the bipod. Upper handguard. I'm not gonna touch the barrel and the gas tube because it's all full of fat and oil from the last time I went shooting with it. As you can see, okay, the gas system runs here above the barrel. There is the rod with the recoil spring wrapped around it that has a little hook. I don't know if you're able to see it. This hook is basically the one that hooks up to the bolt carrier via this little thing, like the, how do you call it, whatever, the one that you use to rack it in the back. So with this one links the bolt carrier to the recoil spring, more specifically the little hook, okay? Which means, whenever you shoot, bullet travels, gas follows, is vented here in the back, pushes the rod with the recoil spring, and cycles the rifle. Pretty simple. A nice little remark on the SIG 550 here on the side, the bullets, when they hit the extraction and they fly out, they always hit this part. So you pretty much can tell how much a rifle has been abused. You know, you can kind of derive the round count, roughly, based on how much it's ruined here on this part. Some people on the web put some duct tape around it to prevent the rifle from, I don't know, from looking more old or whatever, but I don't really care. You know, if you use it, and yeah, you don't have to hide it. Inside to clean it, it's pretty easy. No rocket science on this side. The gas port is pretty straightforward. Normal, or it has a normal hole and then a bigger hole for when it's really dirty. In the military, we sometimes put it on dirty, so more gas flows to your gun. This is because when you shoot full auto, it shoots a bit faster and it's more fun. To be honest, I never experienced a situation where the rifle was failing to cycle on normal and you had to put it on sort of dirty. But yeah, some say that you have this option. You know, having more gas flow to the gun is gonna have an impact on the life cycle of the parts. It's gonna, I don't know, maybe they're gonna break earlier. That's a pretty sturdy rifle, and I never really heard about the rifle, you know, cracking down or breaking. Nothing. To be honest, this is a real tank, so I only heard good things. I heard bad things, for instance, because they weigh a lot, and you cannot attach anything on these ones. Basically, the way you get them on day one is the way you give them back on day X when you're done. There's no whiz bang stuff that you can attach, like, you know, it doesn't have any picatinny rates whatsoever, nothing. The flash hider is actually, it's not even, it's an integral part of the barrel, okay? There's one thing that pisses me off from the 5.5.1, we'll get back to it later. You have no options of attaching anything. The barrel is just machined out of a whole block of steel, including the flash hider. I always have a hard time putting this together. It's due to the fact that on a shooting session I ran probably too much full auto on this gun, and the plastic was not really melting, but it bended a little bit, and now every time I have to put it together, it's like put it back together, it's a bit more hard than usual. But yeah. Reassembling the gun. Bull carrier inside, and then I set this little handle, charging handle here, back. It's a bit annoying how when you also clean the gas tube, which I didn't show you this time, you have to make sure that when you put it back, the little hook is looking downwards, otherwise you'll not be able to stick this one inside. Why is this annoying? Because if the hook is not looking exactly how it should, you cannot put this one stuck the charging layer inside, and then, you know, turning it around is a bit of a pain, so you get all your hands dirty, so just you know, quite a little insider about the 50. Inside the trigger housing, you can see there's quite a lot of springs. You can actually, for those of you who are wondering, you cannot attach the full auto lower to the normal semi-auto upper, okay? I'm gonna show you what happens if you try. Okay, so this is my 5.5.1 upper. Let's say that I got this one from the army and I wanna run a full lot of 5.5.1. You actually can, okay? You can attach the front takedown pin, but it's not gonna fit due to this little, I don't know, it seems like a little lever or a hook here on the side. It doesn't fit, okay? You have here on the upper, it's the upper right part of the lower, you have a little metal protruding from the side, which doesn't allow you to fix this one on it, and therefore, I'm sorry to say, your full auto lower would only work on a full auto upper. There's another difference, I believe. No, it's not. Okay. No, that's it. Let's put this one together. So, talking about the 5.5.1, this is actually the first rifle that I bought back in 2008 or 2009, something like this. I didn't have a lot of money back then, so this I had to save a lot for this one. Being my first gun, I really shot it a lot. And by a lot, I mean, I don't know, around 10,000 rounds perhaps, something like this, maybe a little less. For me, it's a lot, you know. Not being a service rifle, it's quite a high round count. I painted it in different colors. I ran it with Picatinny right at the top, with forward grip. It's kind of a pain, okay? Let me tell you why. This one came with a fixed diopter, which is great, to be honest. I'm becoming more and more a fan of a diopter sight, the more I see how much of a pain is it to always adjust these little sights, when you take them off and you fix them. I mean, the diopter sights are always there. If they work one, they probably work twice also the next time, okay? But yeah, sorry for the digression. If you put a rail on this sucker, which some people do on the web, you might see them. First of all, it's heavy, okay? The Picatinny rail on this one is pretty heavy. Another thing that sucks is that when you mount it, you have to sort of, you fix it here at the front, okay? And then you have to screw it and sort of here inside a little hole that is on the diopter, in the rear side of the diopter. So you slide it in and then you have to, you know, screw it here so that it's not fit, you know? The problem is that when you've got this on, you cannot dismount, you cannot take off the gun, take apart the gun. Okay? What do you mean? If you take the lower off and you want to clean, also, I don't know, you want to clean the gas piston or whatever, the plastic part will not come off, okay? Because you got here, it's blocked by the Picatinny. So after you got it all lined up well, you shot it and you think, okay, now I found the right setup, and you want to clean the gun, you gotta think about it, okay? Then you gotta retake away the Picatinny rail so that you're able to clean the rock. That's my wife, by the way, cleaning. Not cleaning, cooking. Or there's gonna be some cleaning to do later on for sure, anyway. So yeah, the Picatinny rail sucks a little bit. On the here, on the other hand, you can, there are some little holes on the handguard, you can attach some rails also here. Also this, I mean, I would attach a flashlight here. I didn't, but that's probably the only thing I would do. I sort of didn't like the grip here on the side, because, at the bottom, because the handguard, as you can see, it's not that, I don't know, it's a bit loose. It's not really loose, it doesn't really affect when you're shooting. When it gets a bit hot, you see things kind of get a little bigger, so you don't really notice it. Once the gun is hot, it's really tight. However, whenever you're on a grip here, it can really disturb it, you know. It moves around, even that 1 millimeter, you feel it a lot more, it's a lot worse than if you just hold the whole thing together. Therefore, in the end, I was like, fuck it, and I took it off, and I just run the gun, you know, like, yeah, like it comes out of the box. Gas system is pretty much the same as with the 550. There's no really need to change it with something more fancy. Also here, we got a problem that the muzzle device is one thing with the barrel, okay? No comment on that one. If you got a suppressor, which I do, you're gonna have a hard time fixing this one on the barrel. Actually, you can't, there's no way. Not really, okay, what should I say? It was a bit short-sighted, maybe. And for sure, nowadays, it's a bit short-sighted to sell something like this. Back then, in the 90s, or whenever this thing started to go on the market, perhaps it was not a big deal. Okay, you've got many rifles dating back from these times that had all sorts of bizarre muzzle devices, such as the Steyrog or, I don't know, G36. Everyone has got its own proprietary muzzle device. It was not thought that you would have a suppressor, like a standard suppressor for NATO forces fitting on each gun. Nevertheless, things have changed. I think some of the newer guns made by Swiss Arms, which is the new SIG, some of the newer guns have like an A2 or an A2 similar flash hider, which you can also take off and mount another one if you like. But yeah, the damage is done. You know, if you're stuck with something like this, your only option is either change barrel, expensive, change hopper, expensive, change gun, doesn't make sense. So yeah, this one is the last addition to my collection, the 553. I didn't buy a 552, I didn't have the money. They are getting more expensive every day, these guns. I don't know, like the newer ones cost around $4,000, okay? Things in Switzerland are really expensive, you know, probably it's cheaper in America, even though it's made in Switzerland. But still, back then when I bought the 551, it was 2.9, you know, $2,900. Nowadays, it costs almost $3,900, okay? And it's the same gun, you don't get any extras. You get even less, actually, because the newer guns from Swiss Arms, I don't think they come with a cleaning kit. Mine came with a cleaning kit and two magazines. The newer ones just comes, I don't know, the gun, one magazine, and that's it. Then good luck. This one, this is pretty cool. It's the one that I like the most. Okay, of course I'm aficionado to my 5.56 because it was my first privately purchased gun. But this one is just badass, you know. I bought it secondhand. I had a little low round count, which is good. I don't really care because the thing will be to last. It's really heavy, okay? I got a SCAR, I got a G36, I tried a bunch of AR-15 SBRs, and this is probably, this is by far the heaviest, okay? With the suppressor on it, it's nose heavy. It's a total opposite of AR-15, but still. You can tell here, you can tell there's quality, okay? You can tell that this thing is never gonna let you down. Everything on this gun is like more heavy probably than it should, but it's really for heavy use, okay? I would recommend it over any other SBR out there on the market. It's like a little tank, okay? As said before, this gun is different from the 5.56, practically only based on the working mechanism, okay? The working mechanism, this one is the same on the 5.50 and the 5.51. I'm gonna show you how it looks like in a second. But before, let me just stop on a little detail that I think really sucks and that they haven't changed in years. You see the charging handle? Okay? Do you see how much clearance you have with the EOTech that I have mounted on top? I don't know if you can. There's like 1 millimeter or even less of clearance, okay? So when this thing cycles, I don't know, it's like really 1 millimeter, okay, of clearance. So if you have a malfunction and you have to sort of, you know, tap and rack the weapon and you have an optics mounted on it, you're gonna have a hard time, okay? You're gonna have a hard time, and more often than not, the charging handle gets on your way and with the optics, and it hurts. Okay. What's funny, we got this gun in the army now, running around, I think, as Sturmgewehr 04, because it was introduced in 2004 for special purpose units, like the paratroopers and stuff like that. These guys are using the 5.56 long barrel, okay? They run it with a little endpoint micro and the magnifier. The endpoint micro is good, I guess, because it doesn't, the width, it's not as bad as with the EOTech, so the clearance is not really much of a big deal. But what's cool about the 5.56 they're using in the army, the charging handle seems to be, instead of having this little angle, you know, like whatever it is, you know, a little less than the 90 degrees, the one from the army has a 90 degrees angle, so from 0 degrees, it's horizontal actually. So with that one, even if you run an EOTech, since it's horizontal, it's easier to record that. I don't see those on the market, to be honest. I would like to buy one. The only one that I can see are the normal ones, the canted ones, and they cost like $100, which pisses me off quite a lot. I would rather steal one from the army, no joke. If somebody's from the army seeing this, no joke. Yeah, something that I might consider buying a horizontal one instead of the canted, but it just pisses me off that it's not really clear which one you get and if it's officially on the market. It just pisses me off. But without further ado, let's open it, let's see how the working mechanism on the 5.53 looks like. You know, taking this guy apart, it's the same as with the other ones. You take the charging handle out. Let the bolt slide the back. What's interesting, here. You know, the 5.52, if you open it in the back, you take the rear, once you take the rear takedown pin and you out and you slide above, slide the upper receiver up, sort of, the recoil spring, pop, flies out, okay? Because it's like an AK. The recoil spring is not fixed like in an AK where you can take the upper shell off and it says fixed. The recoil spring here just literally flies off. The 5.53, it's not the case, because as I said, it's the same as with the 5.50. I managed to take it off. Here's all the difference, okay? The recoil spring is hooked up to the bolt carrier, like this. It goes in, you see the little hook that I was talking about? It goes here inside. And once you link it to the charging handle, it's fixed, okay? So when the gun cycles, this one goes up, pushes back. Brass is extracted, then no more gas, comes back at the front, the recoil spring drags it, takes the next round, and that's it. You got the magic. What's nifty about this one, the gas valve has four positions now. Finally they woke up, they understood that, you know, if you buy such a small gun, you might have other uses than just shooting at 300 yards. This one has settings for shooting normal, you know, normal conditions, such as the 5.0, dirty conditions, so 5.0, and then it's got a suppress setting and a semi-auto or bolt action setting. What do you mean by bolt action is that if you choose the 4 position, no gas will cycle through a weapon. No gas will cycle through a weapon, this means this gun is just, it's not semi-auto because it's a semi-auto by default. It's like a bolt action. You have to manually charge it after each round. I'm not really sure what the idea was behind this, but it's still cool, you know, it's something that you don't see in any other gun probably. So why not? I'll put everything together. Of course I would like to get later on like a railed forehand for this one, but as with anything in Switzerland, it's terribly expensive. I'm not exactly swimming in money, it's gonna have to wait a little bit. The handguard, putting the handguard on this one is a bit of a pain. Takes some training. Back, there you go. Bit of a pain to test how it rests because there's the yield pick on it, of course. And it hurts my finger. With the 20 round mag, it's a really nice package, okay? With the stock folded and 20 round mag, this gun is definitely compact, okay? It's as compact as a G36, if not more, because you can have a 20 round mag, which you can't with a G36. And a G36 is like so high, you know, that it's just retarded. Whereas this one, if you take the Biotech off, it's definitely a hell of a compact gun. Okay. The stock is sturdy, unlike with the SCAR, where it's really flimsy. Okay, it's not adjustable or nothing, but it's a really good stock. I love it. On this one, I have the Rotex, or rather Vortex, muzzle device, which allows me to run it with a suppressor. Okay. I'm not seeing other videos. I do have one of BMP's suppressors, the Rotex 5 compact. Pretty easy. That. There you go. Looks pretty cool. As said, it's really nose heavy, okay? I haven't shot it yet with the suppressor on. But yeah, it's something I will definitely do in the future, and I will upload a video as soon as I do. It's really cool, okay? With the suppressor on it, you know, SBRs are really loud. This little muzzle device that I have, it's open at the front, so it kind of echoes a lot when you shoot. With the suppressor, things should be a lot better. It's pretty much, it's the same muzzle device that I have in this car. And it's made expressly for BFD suppressors. It's no, no problem with that. Yeah. Precision. I haven't shot this one on 300 yards, but reading through some forums, people seem to say that with the proper equipment, maybe on a line, on a sandbag or something like this, it's not too bad. I don't know if you can compare it to the 550. This one, precision of 300 yards, is outstanding with iron sights. Same goes for the 551. 553 I haven't tried yet on that distance, but should be no problem, I guess. I'm also not a big fan of the 300 yard shooting. You know, here in Switzerland, actually, it's pretty, almost the only thing they do is shooting at 300 yards. But still. What I like to do with this one, you know, just some more tactical stuff. I can finally run some optical equipment without having to attach like big ass Picatinny reins that are super heavy and expensive. Once I have the right handguard for this one, I'll be able to run with the grip, which is for sure a good idea. And yeah, this actually is not from SIG any longer. This one was made by Swiss Arms. Swiss Arms is the, former SIG. Whereas my other two guns are still made from SIG, you know? Good old SIG. So yeah. If I had to own only one out of these three, I would probably go with the 553, okay? The 553 doesn't cut any corners. It's sturdy, it's not gonna fail you. The mechanism is outstanding, okay? It's proven. Battle proven, I don't know. The track record seems, I mean, you see some naval forces, for instance in France, grind this gun. But it's not a lot of fuss about it, like with the HK416 or other M4s. You see them a lot in, no, you actually do see them in movies sometimes, but yeah, it's Hollywood, so what do you want to do? Nevertheless, from what I can tell, from my service, and everybody else that I know, the system runs flawlessly. At least on a 550, so I don't see what should be different on this one. So if you had the chance to take only one, I mean, if I had the chance, I would take the 552. I'm actually glad to have all three of them now. I'm considering in the future whether to upgrade maybe and have buy an extra lower, like an upper, with the long barrel configuration, just for the collection. But I don't really have any purpose for it now. I'm glad to have the whole collection. I might consider buying a grenade launcher for this one. Actually, I saw one for sale. They're not that expensive. It's just a bit hard to get the buying permit for that one. But I used it in the army and it's really cool. So it's something that may come up in the future as I have more money. Okay, yeah, sorry, that's my wife. Thanks for watching, and yeah, as usual, if you got questions or rants against my wife, feel free to post them. And yeah, where should I stay? Bye.